Good evening, everyone. My name's Professor John Dewar. I'm the Vice Chancellor of La Trobe University. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet tonight and pay my respects to their elders, past and present. I'm absolutely delighted to be here to open tonight's Bold Thinking event. This is the first of our Bold Thinking lectures for 2017, but more importantly, it's the first Bold Thinking lecture we've held in Bendigo. So thank you for supporting it. It will encourage us to do it again. The Bold Thinking series was something we started last year under the leadership of Professor Chris Mackey, and has quickly become an important forum for discussing significant contemporary issues. Bold Thinking has considered topics as diverse as literacy and numeracy in Australian schools, revenge porn, decency and the law, the impact of social media on news reporting, the ways that gambling can affect sport, and family violence and alcohol. And what unites all of the topics is that these are areas in which La Trobe has real research. The Bold Thinking series as a way of sharing with the broader community some of the China upheavals that bring in their train major shifts in institutions and structures. The truth is we can't really take anything for granted these days. And closer to home, we've seen the re-emergence of Pauline Hanson. Some commentators have seen all of this, particularly the ascendancy of Trump, in terms of the politics of resentment. And one might say that some of our own politicians have indulged that working class dissatisfaction and fear. But what's, I think, really interesting about tonight's perspective, discussion, is that it looks at these issues from a local point of view. So how have all these international trends and forces played out here in Bendigo? How do political and economic structural change affect individuals and communities, especially in regional areas? Is there anything special about Bendigo, and how has this mediated the community's response to these broader trends? And just as importantly, as considering the causes of all of this, we'll discuss the role of community leaders and individuals in a city like Bendigo in helping the community navigate their way through them. How can we help to create a vibrant, sustainable, and multicultural city of the future? Now, my pleasant task is to introduce the members of our panel. And I'm going to start from this end. Someone I think you probably all know very well, Margot Spalding, former Telstra Businesswoman of the Year, spokesperson for the Believe in Bendigo campaign that's fought against the hate and intolerance that arose during demonstrations against a mosque being located here in Bendigo. And she was, of course, the co-founder of the well-known Bendigo-based furniture company, Jimmy Possum. To her right is Dr. Julie Rudner, a senior lecturer in the Department of Social Inquiry in La Trobe's College of Arts, Social Science and Commerce. Julie aims to shift the way we think about risk and uncertainty and is interested in how we can create a what she calls public knowing of risk. She's also interested in promoting active citizenship and the interface between policy and lived experience. Just skipping over Francis for the moment, but I'll come back to him, is Tasneem Chopra, a La Trobe graduate and a curator, consultant, author, and activist. She grew up in Bendigo and now works in Melbourne as an independent cross-cultural consultant. She delivers workshops on diversity, identity, and racism, and is a strong advocate for social change and justice. She's also the chairperson of Lentil as Anything, one of the social enterprise catering partners that we were delighted to welcome onto our campus just 10 days ago to help us celebrate our 50th anniversary in a big party. And then to Tasneem's right is Rob Hunt, Managing Director of the Bendigo and Adelaide Bank for 21 years. In fact, he was with the bank for 36 years in total and guided that organisation through many challenges and oversaw significant growth and improvements in customer outcomes. Rob is the architect of the community bank model that's now used by communities across Australia to provide key infrastructure and essential services through a local commercial business. And we were delighted to confer on Rob an honorary doctorate from the university in 1998. And then last, but by no means least, please welcome tonight's host, acclaimed broadcaster, journalist, and writer, Francis Leach. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our panel, and I'll hand over to Francis to get us started. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming along to our first event here in Bendigo, and it's a real thrill to be here with you tonight to discuss this important issue. Just so that you understand the format a little bit, we'll be in discussion for an hour on the stage, trying to cover as much ground as we possibly can. And then we open it up to you to be involved in the discussion. And it will be a discussion based on my own rules. They're called the civil society rules. Different ideas, mutual respect. And then under those rules, everyone is free to participate in that forum a little later on as you get the chance to ask our panellists any questions or offer some insight and ideas of your own, because Bold Thinking Series is all about trying to move the debate forward and learn something and challenge each other in a forum competing ideas to maybe learn something new about an issue that we might think all of us in our own little way we've got a fairly good handle on. So we're not here to relitigate what happened in this city over the last couple of years. That's pointless, and that's not what we're here for. But we are here to learn from it. And there might be some difficult questions that need to be asked, and there might be some answers that you might not want to hear. That's part of it. That's part of what Bold Thinking is about and what this series is about, is listening. Because if there's one element as a journalist and broadcaster that increasingly alarms me, is that there's a hell of a lot of people. That's something we're going to do tonight. So let me begin with you, Rob, down the end. On and off over the years, but if I've never come here before, how would you have described Bendigo to me as somebody who just arrived in town? What would you say were the characteristics of this city that you experienced for over two decades?
Francis, I think the most redeeming feature that springs to mind immediately is that this city has been a city of enormous innovation and response sometimes to challenge. It's been a pioneering city. It started in those early gold rush days. It went through series of flashes of brilliance, but then there have been those times where we've gotten a little lazy and we've lived on past glories. And so what you reflect is you see some of those past glories in the grand old buildings and so forth, but sometimes we forget, you know, what a tremendous, wonderful city this is. And I think in the future, this city has an enormous amount to offer in terms of what the future sustainable community will look like, what communities will look like into the future, and can in fact help shape some of that, as it has in past debates.
Tasneem, after the events of the last few years in and around the planning issue of the mosque and what came after it, how did all of that change your perception of what this community actually was and what it stood for?
For me, I felt that much of the negativity of that issue had been imported. It didn't seem to resonate with the ethos of the community that I grew up with, which was very welcoming, it was very all Australian, but at the same time, in being that, it was fair go. It was inclusive.
Because you grew up here.
I grew up here. So my memories are very much centred around a community, a wellness of connectivity between school and health and education and employment, where everybody knew everyone, and the sense of being raised effectively by the entire township, in a sense. I mean, it wasn't that small, but that was the feeling that I got. So I think that's a, or I think Muslims in Bendigo are being questioned about whether they belonged here.
Margot, what shifted then from what Tasneem's experience was as a child growing up, feeling included, feeling, you know, very much part of the fabric of this community, then maybe feeling somewhat outside it?
I think, and Tasneem says mostly from outside, but I do think there's an element in Bendigo who have become disgruntled and were unhappy about the mosque in that particular regard. But I also think, I only came here as a 16-year-old and I found Bendigo, and I was an orphan then, and I found Bendigo a really welcoming place. But when I was bringing up our hordes of children, there wasn't much difference in people in Bendigo.
How do you mean?
Well, because most people were, you know, like me, from a British heritage. And I used to cart all our kids in the yellow van down to the Vic Market so that, you know, we could mix with and see different cultures. Because I think, and I think that's part of the problem in the last couple of years, that Bendigo, unlike Shepparton, didn't have a really diverse population. And I think that that's a shame for Bendigo, really. And I think when you were growing up, Tasneem, you would be the age of my kids. But there wasn't really a lot of people of difference. We employed in our business a guy from British Ghana, and he was really happy because he loved it. This was like 20 years ago. There was only 3 black people in Bendigo, and he thought he was fabulously special. Mm. But, you know, every people in Bendigo got, or some people got a shock a few years ago thinking that, you know, we're going to be inundated by different people, which would be great anyway.
But that's not, in a sense, that lineage of the city isn't self-selecting. I mean, it was, or was it? I mean, we made it just a product of circumstance. So it isn't intrinsically a less valued experience in a community if you are monocultural, is it? Why does that have to be the case?
Say that again.
Well, I'm saying that a community that might be monocultural by happenstance... Yep. Isn't necessarily intrinsic of offering a poorer community experience.
No, not of course. But I think communities benefit by a very diverse population. That's what I think. I think it's exciting. Everybody has lots to offer, so you end up with a much better community in the end. But I just think in Bendigo that some people got a shock and led by others. That, and I think leadership plays a very big part in this, that they got a shock at thinking there was a whole bunch of new people coming to Bendigo that they weren't happy about.
And there's a lot of misinformation and all that.
Misinformation, lies, hatred, the whole box and dice.
We'll talk about that. But Julie, you work in this area when it comes to the built environment and I guess, you know, harmonious communities and the way, not only how they're planned, but how they organically grow. And you can spot difference in them too. So, for instance, in Bendigo, the mosque became an issue, but close by in other cities, in Ararat and in Horsham, and of course in Shepparton, where there's been a community for a while, it wasn't so. So what were you discovering in your work that was able to pinpoint a difference in those communities, that they had different reactions?
I think each community was different. For Horsham, I think for them attracting workers into the city and keeping it vibrant and keeping it strong is really important.
So there was a mutual self-interest there, wasn't there? They needed the work and they were happy to have the workers who were prepared to do the job.
And same with some places like Nil, and there's other researchers who have done some work on that area. If you look at Ararat, I spoke to some people there, and what they felt is that the Muslim people in that community work with others in the meatworks and other areas, and their place of worship is in the centre of town, so to actually move it out of the premises which weren't adequate to something else wasn't a shock because people are already familiar with it. Mm. And the same with Shepparton, I think they're up to their 6th mosque now. And so I think part of it, and what the research tends to show and what urban design is based on, is when you have greater interactions with people from different walks of life, you tend to have greater tolerance. That doesn't mean acceptance, but at least an ability to negotiate space with these people without having to engage in racial incivilities.
Can I just say, we talk about monoculturalism and how that intrinsically is not a negative thing, but from the perspective of someone who's outside of that demographic and the experiences that I had, although it was inclusive, I can confidently say that I spent most of my formative years, which although functional here, always looking to see myself reflected.
So you were conscious of that?
Oh, definitely. I was a brown pea in a white pod for years and years and years. And people of colour grow up with all those challenges of constantly trying to fit in and wanting to belong while I wasn't made to feel that I didn't belong. I was aware of my difference. And faith-wise, the only mosque that we ever visited was in Melbourne whenever we drove up down, drove to Melbourne. Yeah. And when I had those experiences, they were very, very special because you take for granted in Bendigo, there are churches, you're surrounded by churches. And that I grew up going to Mass, I grew up going to Catholic school and to an Anglican school, so I was always attending services and never thought any ill of it.
Can I just ask you there? I mean, just in terms of that, why did you, given your heritage, why did your parents send you to those schools invite you to explore or to be part of those religious rituals?
They didn't.
Was it an assimilation thing for
them? No, it was. They didn't feel it was going to, if anything, they felt it would enrich my world understanding of faith, period. And they didn't have any negative issues about Christianity at large. And there was no proselytising per se. It was very, very, I guess, religion light, if I can say that, attending those particular services. But I was curious and I was interested. And it was
But it offered no threat, did it?
It didn't. And by the same token, I was often asked to share my faith on occasions when it mattered, like in Ramadan or on Eid in a special occasion. So that was an opportunity for me to share. And I've got lots of stories about that, but I don't know if I get to get to those. But what I would say is that not seeing yourself reflected in your broader community does impact your sense of self and well-being. And whether it's TV, whether it's media, whether it's society at large, that lacking diversity does have an impact on your well-being.
But Rob, Bendigo has for a long time had its great pride is its relationship with the Buddhist community and the huge facility here in this community, which is renowned throughout Victoria and beyond as a place of worship for people of that faith. So,
yeah, Francis, I moved away when I retired. I moved where my grandchildren are and my kids are, and down the coast. And I was a bit shocked, and I said to Margot, I was a bit shocked at the way it was being explained, at least when I read about it, because that I'd not seen that. Other than it did appear to be people reacting to false information and fear was generated by a lot of this false information, and it just shocked me a bit. And I said, look, Bendigo need to stand, anger, resentment, all those negative things.
This is not us. So when does a community sit down and decide what us is? Because that would seem to be something that was a vacuum in this particular instance for Bendigo when this event blew up.
Well, I do think what Margot said is correct in the sense that, the leadership that was required instantly, was necessary to say this is not us, and that's what happened. But there were still those living in worry with misinformation, and it seemed to me it just didn't reflect. Knowing the city, I just didn't feel right to me that this was a true statement of Bendigo. Yes, it was. Its history and its makeup was largely coming out of those early beginnings and the Cornish miners and the makeup of the immigration in those days. But I didn't see that the sort of resistance and fear that I saw in those articles.
But it's fascinating because I've been lucky enough to travel the world and see cities that do have strong identities and very powerful identities. I'll give you one simple example from my current profession as a sports journalist. In the city of Liverpool, they still refuse to buy Rupert Murdoch's The Sun newspaper. Point blank, it doesn't sell there. And the reason why is because The Sun newspaper in 1989 blamed the people of Liverpool and the 96 people who died at the Hillsborough Stadium for their deaths. And I know the people who ran the justice for the 96 campaign, and they finally got their justice last year when there was a judicial inquiry. And that community decided what it valued, and it had always decided what it valued a long time before the judiciary caught up with it. So how does a community get to a point like they did in Liverpool? And it's pretty much right across the city. I don't even bother selling it there anymore. That they believe, they know what they stand for, they have a cultural identity, a shared cultural identity, and they're powerfully represented.
I have to be a little bit careful with what I say from time to time, and sometimes I'm not always good at that. But I think a few things collided at that time in Bendigo. One was horrific things happening internationally in the name of Islam, which I don't agree with. So that was one thing. The council in Bendigo was hammered for various things that people, some people in Bendigo didn't like. And the mosque issue got caught up in that. We also, at the time, this is where I'm being seriously careful, just between you and me, that we had some questionable councillors at the time. So the council was on the nose. There was all these dreadful issues happening overseas, which are very real and they're very frightening. And for those who don't know, then, you know, you can relate everybody the same. And you have these councillors who, in my opinion, were showing appalling leadership. So there was, and so the council was trying to get everything right and wasn't really getting anything right in this regard because they weren't doing anything. So nobody was actually doing anything. So I think, and a lot of people were watching, and good people were watching thinking all this ugliness would go away. Well, the ugliness is still there overseas, so, you know, that's not. So that's where I think Bendigo lacked leadership, and I'm not criticising or having a crack at anyone in that regard, but everybody was watching and waiting for somebody else to stand up and show leadership. And this is all my opinion, of course, but that's what I think happened. And the council couldn't do it, because lots of people hated them for the creation, lots of people hated them for hacks and for various other things. So
it's like a perfect storm of maybe some local issues.
Yeah, well, the perfect storm is correct.
And assumptions. Even in 1921, there were, you know, at least 26 people who were, I think, identified as Muslim. And there was Jews here, there were people from Asia, I think.
Yeah.
You know, like in terms of the numbers, and if you look through, they've always been part of Bendigo's population. And I think as well, different alliances, and this is what comes up with Pauline Hanson. We laugh and say, okay, well, 20 years ago, you're against the Asians, now you're against the Muslims, who's next? But what that also shows is different alliances when people try to form an identity. And one of the things that I found really interesting is some of the people protesting against the mosque were also trying to identify as being more, I guess, supportive or less likely to engage in homophobia or violence against women. And these same groups, given a different circumstance, would still target those groups. So part of it was forming these arguments. And I think the way that the debate went is there wasn't the space to, I guess, have these conversations of who are we? Not necessarily who are we going to be, but who do we...
Important point. Screaming match. And it's not, and I'm not suggesting for a moment that it was just, you know, particular to Bendigo. I think the wider culture has got to a point now where we don't have civil forums to discuss difficult ideas. That's part of, as I said, what we're doing here. But there wasn't that forum, and so it got very heated very quickly, and fear became the only currency that would be exchanged. So it's, Rob, as a leader and somebody who's been in the community, how do you wrestle that back as somebody who wants to be able to set an example or provide leadership and explain difficult issues to a maybe sceptical cohort of people?
Well, put simply, with facts. Because the problem is that, you know, while people are dealing with misinformation, they're going to end up with the wrong answer. And my view is that you've got to have, you know, got to have the facts, and they've got to be, you know, put straight. And we have to be clear about our future, you know. And Francis, I've got very strong views that one of the unintended consequences of centralisation generally, that's centralisation of capital markets, centralisation of decision making, centralisation of telling us, you know, what we've got to do, when we've got to do it, and how we've got to do it, is that we've become dependent on the middle to tell us when it's okay to participate, and we don't participate enough in building our community. We've got lots of silos of activity, but we don't participate in building our balance sheet, in our future, and building our arguments for participation in the future. A lot of the debates are about these almost small issues in the overall, because we haven't got a grand vision. And that's my view, is that in the absence of clarity about, you know, what we really are. We have been an outstanding community many times in its history. We've been less outstanding also in some times. But now is the greatest opportunity to change some of that conversation. And it has to start from within. If you took the combined intellect in this room and applied it to any problem that confronted this community, you would come up with a range of alternatives to solve it. How often do we have those conversations? We don't.
Now it's time to do it, but do you feel that there's still the goodwill amongst the community such as Bendigo to do the hard work? Because it'll be hard work. It's not going to be easy.
No, I do. I do think there is the capacity. I think the fact that we have people here tonight to discuss this issue means there's buy-in. But I think even beyond that, I think it's absolutely essential when you're talking about planning for change and inclusivity and vision, include those very members of the community who are central to the conversation. So everyone's talking about Muslims, no one's really talking to them. Give them the platform. Who writes the news about minority issues? It's not the minorities. Who writes the headlines about minority communities? It's not them. Who runs the radio programs? Who runs the networks? Who runs the front page? Who writes history? It's always done from the position of the privileged. And as long as that continues, and you're not having representation that is authentic from the very communities who are constantly being pilloried, you're just going to reinvent the same scenario. So I think you have, yes, you have the kudos and the capital in this room, but as I understand the demographic of the Muslim community, and certainly that who are behind this mosque, is a very middle class, to a large extent, educated cohort of the community. We're not talking necessarily about, you know, people with zero skills, capacities, and language capacity. We've got people who have the ability to contribute, but are always on the outer and never on the front.
Part of that, just coming in there, is that they've also been nervous. And there's two demographics of Muslim people in Bendigo, from what I see. There's skilled migrants and there's irregular.
20 who are in the position and are contributing to that space, but rarely given the platform. So a lot of them are seeking out independent media as an outlet to engage with, and they're doing it, and they're doing it loud, and they're making some amazing traction. But that's not necessarily going to be picked up.
No, the problem becomes with that also is that people then get caught in their own self-reflecting silos, where they'll talk to people of a like mind who will reinforce their values and ideas, and often more acutely demonise those who are different. And that's part of the problem, where we get this overheated conflict when they do come together. And it's interesting, because I'm speaking to you, Margot and Julie, part of the problem was that when this community was faced with a challenge to discuss what it wanted to be, there were people who didn't want to talk to each other, who point-blank refused to even consider meeting someone who was walking in a different set of shoes.
Can I just say at this point, part of the work that I do as a consultant is engaging on misconceptions about Islam and Muslims in the West. And myself and a colleague have many times done polls in classrooms, particularly in rural Melbourne and almost into country Victoria, where we'd say, off the cuff, how many people in this room have negative feelings about Muslims, you know, and like 90% of the kids will put up their hands. And they will follow that with, how many of you have actually met a Muslim? And nobody puts up their hand. It's not rocket science. There is no engagement, there is no conversation, there's a mass of misinformation that legitimately builds fear. I would be scared too if I didn't know a Muslim. Seriously, I would be like, really? That's what they think, that's what they believe? So how do you combat that? You give platform to those voices.
Can I think, part of it, yes, I agree, media and the polarisation and all of these things, but I think there's a fundamental, it's not bad or good, it's just a fundamental thing that we have in multicultural nations, and that is, in order to recognise difference, we have a lot of policies about multiculturalism, non-discrimination, which I fully support, but within the language that we use, it allows us to keep separating. So people who come from the dominant group, which tends to be white, let's say Anglo-Saxon, it means that multiculturalism is out there. And I think that, for me, I've been really interested with the idea of hybridity. What does it mean to go beyond multiculturalism? Because if you really look at history and trade and ideas, all of us are affected. When we're using mobile phones, the vehicles that we drive, everything we have are from science, social theory, philosophy from around the world, but we don't realize how much it's actually integrated within us. And even by defining ourselves against another person, we're actually taking their culture into ourselves because of that need to define. And so I think in that way, to try to get to that sophisticated level of discussion, is where we need to go.
So do we have to, in that sense, and we presume in the setting of this question that we want a cosmopolitan community, some people might not. So where's their voice going to be heard, and how do you then deal with that? If people do feel that the predominant culture is one that they're comfortable in and it sustains them and it gives them what they want from life and a happy life with their family and a community they like, how do you talk to those people and what do you say to them?
Oh, I think everyone has a seat at the table. I mean, there has to be... It's a democracy, it is. And you do have voices from all corners of the spectrum who are entitled to contribute and participate. But what has traditionally happened is it has not included marginalised voices. It hasn't. So we're not going to know what that looks like until we actually try.
Because it's interesting, isn't it, in the sense that in a world where there's rapid change and people feel changes are... of the, and therefore they're going to change that they get a convergence of those things?
Well, I suspect that it all has an impact. I think for many years, you know, even good ideas have sort of fallen foul because you've got to go and convince someone who doesn't live here, who can't spell Bendigo, that it's actually right for government or corporates to be spending money here. And to agree, we've lost some of the capacity to produce that investor readiness argument, that conversation. Because in commerce, no one talks about differences. We talk about the 20 things that make us make us a powerful force. We don't talk about the three things that are different about us.
So you identify the things that make you strong.
Yes. Yeah. Well, to me,
for success,
we're spending all the time talking about the things that are different. In our backgrounds or our religion or whatever, instead of the 25 opportunities that we have to work together.
That's right.
I agree. To a degree, one of the things, and I know I've said this many times to government, is that in Federation was meant to come closer and engage the locals in a conversation, but there's a series of structures that are built up in that centralisation. I call it unintended consequences. But the more that the government accumulate, you know, the transfer system, the tax system, and then redistribute and do it in the way of grants, the more the capital markets get centralised and someone who lives somewhere else decides where the investments will lie, the more we've pulled back as a community, instead of the more we should have stepped forward and said, we've got an opportunity. Hmm. And this wasn't about, you know, was when we asked the community, well, how many were default, right? And there was a silence in the room, and suddenly they said, it's arguments and structures.
And how do we stop being a passive decisions from elsewhere?
For instance, can I just say, I think same things.
Look at the types of policies that are in place there and how they are different to what we have here in Australia.
Margot, just from the experience that you had with trying to, because you did try, initially you were a little bit reluctant to get involved when you tried to get involved with the issue around the planning for the mosque, and then nothing came of your first attempt, then you created Believe in Bendigo. People had to step up and choose if they wanted to get involved. Did you encounter that it was, they were uncomfortable and reluctant to actually consciously be active in a community campaign?
Well, some people are and were, of course, but the original intent of Believe in Bendigo was to focus on leadership within the community. And so that's the people who, in my chats with other people who were thinking like me, was we needed to engage the leaders in the community. So we had leaders from all sectors of the community, all types, education, political, religious, you know, sporting, business. And so, because they have a level of influence, and I don't mean like unpleasant influence, but, you know, if you're in a position of leadership, say if you're a religious leader, then you have a congregation who, and you have a level of influence over those people. Or say with us, with our factory, at that stage we had about 70 people working there, and they trust us. So if we say, you know, the mosque is okay and Muslims are okay and we're employing refugees and we're people weren't stand up and shout... have a big ripple effect.
But it's not just
But there are, you would hope that lead three or four groups of people here. You know, wouldn't give a rat's for, and it was European. So, you know, it's just a wave that's happening. And then there's the people who truly hate, you know, wake up and think, who am I going to hate today? And so, you know, there's different kinds of people. And who am I going to hate today? We're being encouraged. You know, they're encouraging each other, so getting more on board. But there's a lot of people who, you know, they just need to know that everything's going to be okay.
And yeah, that's okay to a point. Mm-hmm. But aren't we talking about here about an involved citizenry, where it's okay to not have to know everything, but it is important if you do want to create the sort of vibrant cosmopolitan community that we're talking about tonight, to take a stake in. And I think it's one of those issues in the wider Australian community where our civic culture has either not really flourished in a way that means that we're fully engaged and take personal responsibility to make a contribution. We've got a customer service relationship with our municipalities and our levels of government. And the idea of literally and consciously being a citizen isn't discussed and we don't participate in it the way we should.
Okay, I think that is part of the issue. And I think the other issue is that when it comes to Muslims or other minorities, we've got this problem as a country where we keep on otherizing them as if you're Muslim, that's all we can pathologize you with. It's as if I'm sitting here as a Muslim and now I'm going to have a glass in my hand like a Muslim and I'm going to put it down like a Muslim. And like there is just so much more to that. We talk about issues of public housing, education and schooling. Muslims in Bendigo have those same concerns. So their parents, their mothers, their hearts break, they pay taxes, they hate the government sometimes, they have hex issues.
They're
they
just all, like you and me.
Exactly. But we don't even get to the point of seeing them as part of the fabric of who we are because we're still battling with the Muslim issue. And I find that really is going to hamper progress for them as well, feeling like all I can discuss is my scarf.
But part of that also is that my sense is that often for the minority, it's left to you to explain yourself, and that for the wider culture, the inquisitive nature of actually trying to find out for themselves is very limited, and therefore, once again, the power relationship is it's all up to you to explain how you are and why.
I think that goes to the way we discuss critical race theory has been negotiated in this country. I mean,
explain.
I'm constantly being asked where I've come from, and like I like to play, and I say Bendigo, and that's not what people want to hear. They want to know why I'm brown. That's what they want to know. And I mean, to an extent, okay, I accept that historically Australia is roughly 200 years old since Federation. So the newness of entities and difference is something that people are still trying to grasp. I compare that with America, where if you're a Muslim in America, nobody asks you, where are you from? You're American. But then you might have Bengali heritage or Egyptian heritage or something to that. But that's
kind of changing at the moment, though.
No, I think the movement there is still very, very strong. And I think when we're constantly having to explain who I am, where I'm from, the immediate assumption within that is that I don't belong here. And so reclaiming that space and saying, well, you know, I am from Bendigo. And that's what I'm sticking to. And as someone said recently, I add a bit of colour to this stage, so deal with it. And it's not my responsibility to assist racists negotiate their bigotry. It's not my responsibility. It's theirs.
But Tasneem, I ask people all the time. My husband thinks, how can anyone ask so many questions in a day as I do? And especially of people, because I actually like to know. I'm actually interested. Every taxi driver, I grill them about where they've come from, how long they've been, how many kids they've got. Why don't you come to Bendigo for a holiday? But, you know, I'm honestly interested. And I wouldn't be asking you because I'm being trying to exclude you or anyway, or saying, you know, I mean, I envy your skin. I spent years with peroxide trying to get rid of my freckles. But, you know, lots of people would ask because they're interested.
And I grew up with that, so I understand that. And I guess, but from my perspective as someone who's been getting it for 45 years, it's like it gets a bit old at a point where when people congratulate me on my proficiency in the language. Just 2 days ago, I was welcomed to Australia again. And I'm like, and I just smiled and said, thank you. Because, I mean, really, I'm not about to get into a discussion on critical race. I just want my coffee. I just want my coffee. So you have to pick and choose your debates. But as an entity, when we start the conversation with where are you from, as opposed to tell me about you, of us and them.
I want to comment on that because it's quite interesting. I'm a Canadian migrant. I've been here 23 years. And to me, and I've had the thing is, I know what the difference is now, hide, ever, whereas is the notion of civility to just actually be decent.
Well, that's a beautiful segue, Julie, because I was going to ask, No, one of the great challenges, and we sort of talked about this a couple of times already tonight, is the ability to skill people up to have that conversation. I mean, we live in an era where the loudest voices set the agenda in disputes and tend to dominate. And so our forums have become that. Even the ABC's, you know, Monday night forum Q&A has become, it's you know, and I've got good friends who are involved in the program, including the host. And we have argue all the time. I think it's become almost self-defeating in a sense, because it's all about people talking and no one listening. And it's about the loudest voices being heard the longest, and the way that it gets pressed the next day is about who says the most outrageous thing.
Set up, though. It's no longer plausible.
Yeah, but it's no longer an actual conversation, you know, in a sort of a critical thinking exercise where you listen to what somebody has to say who might be of a different political persuasion to you, and sometimes can see that they might be right. So how do we get back to... Because that's where good ideas come from. I mean, the Canadian philosopher, another great Canadian, John Ralston Saul, wrote about critical thinking and the idea that sometimes you have to put all of that aside and be prepared to be wrong. So how do we get back to that? How do we find a way to do that?
I think a lot of what's wrong now is political leadership of any persuasion, with the appalling way in which our national leaders behave.
And but they're a reflection of us. I mean, if we choose not to be involved in the political process, if our citizenry is passive, if we don't put our hand up and run for office, if we don't do all that stuff, we get the leaders we deserve.
Yeah, I don't entirely think about that. I mean, I think that there's ways that people can behave, and I currently think that our political leaders aren't behaving very well.
John?
I think we have to demonstrate it in all of our conversations in the news, of how to listen to what someone says and stick to the idea itself, be able to recognise good points while questioning others, rather than attacking the person. You just have to look on any social media, and within two sentences, we're berating each other. Just because we have a your left or your right, and dismissing each other as if there's no complexity.
Tasneem? I've certainly lost faith in the moral compass of our government.
You have?
Absolutely. Yeah. Having said that, you know, I've spoken with MPs personally, and on a one-on-one basis, particularly on the left, I mean, it seems like there is a glimmer of hope in what they believe in, but I don't see it translating into action, and I think ultimately it's down to the people to make a change.
Well, my view is that we're focusing on all the differences because we haven't got it clear in our mind the big opportunities and the extent to which all the time we avoid talking about the impact of the current distribution model of capital, the impact of centralisation of the capital system. You've got to think about we've got a centralised banking system and decision-making system. We've got a compulsory super, 9% of everything that's 9.5% minimum of everything that's earned here goes in these large pools, and some asset manager or fund manager decides where that goes, and very little comes back to the country. And we can sit and then we can sit and argue that all, you know, they're getting it all wrong, or we can actually get organised to present an irresistible opportunity for some of those funds to come here, because the grand boulevards that you drive down in Bendigo, they were designed by locals for locals with local capital, and they made the decisions. They didn't have to ask anybody else, and they actually did build a community of many people from all over the world into a really strong, resilient community.
So empowering people in that way will give them that sense of shared experience.
Francis, it just stops the focusing on what's different, whether you have a size 9 boot or a size 20 boot. Like, it's all irrelevant if you're actually focusing on the goal, on these bigger things that make us a really strong, you know, vibrant, innovative, creative community of the future. Those conversations are not had enough in our communities. And I've seen differences dissolve instantly when there's a common goal.
So find the common goal.
Well, I was just going to say that's quite interesting in saying that, because if you look at planning regulation and how much it's changed since the first fights to reinvigorate Melbourne's alleyways, and now we have these pop-up shops, pop-up food, it provides a flexibility. And although I do believe in government, I also think that we're really over-regulated, because we want people's houses to be the colour that we like. We want the noise levels to be what's perfect for us all the time. And in assuming or wanting or fighting for those things, we're actually forgetting that we're sharing this place with a whole bunch of other people. Yep. And we need to have the flexibility for all these other people to get engaged and come up with these great ideas.
We're going to go to the floor in a sec, but I just want to quickly run the panel and get an answer to this. Are you optimistic, Rob?
Yes, I am, and I'm an eternal optimist anyway. But from my perspective, the opportunities are so great. The models of distribution of capital for enabling us to regenerate, rejuvenate, and regoal ourselves are going to be redefined. They'll be redefined with our participation, or they'll be redefined anyway.
So you get to choose.
So you get a chance to have a participation. My view is we need action and activity from the business leaders to the community leaders, from all of the communities that have a great opportunity to present an investor readiness or willingness, then now's the time. Because if you look at globally, people have gotten so much, they've depended on the middle for everything, so they're now getting dissatisfied with the decisions that are being made. Government cannot solve everything that confronts us, and never will, and yet they've boxed themselves in a corner where they're expected to. We have to stand up, in my view.
Tasneem, given everything that's gone on here over the last few years, you remain optimistic?
I do remain optimistic because I think hate is finite. I think it's also exhausting. It's not sustainable to be, you know, battering your head against a wall for that long. I'm also optimistic in the resilience and capacity of second-generation women and people of colour in this country who are increasingly skilled in participating and making a difference and redefining the face of what it means to be an Australian.
Julie?
Yes, I'm optimistic. I think that we will find a new way to move forward, and I hope that we actually look inside ourselves to get there rather than always to overseas.
Yeah. Margot?
Well, I'm optimistic because, like everybody else up here, I'm an eternal optimist. But I think also, I just think Bendigo is the best place, and I can't understand why everybody doesn't live here, quite frankly. I think it's great for Bendigo to grow. Some people don't. But I think there's a really simple thing that we've done in our business for years, you know, because our factory is full of introverted people who didn't actually like talking to people very much, so weren't often inclusive. We used to play this thing where you'd get groups of four or five people, and in this case you could do it with 110,000 people in Bendigo, and you get in a group and you talk about, like, everybody's got four or five things in common, you know, you all work at Jimmy Possum, or you did this or you do that, and then every person had to add in something that made them unique. And so our people were always encouraged and trained to think, okay, when we get a new person come in, then let's look at what is, all these things the same. We've all got families, we all care about them, we all go to the footy on Saturday, we do this, we do that. But what is the thing that makes you unique, like anybody in this whole room unique, that you can add to Team Bendigo and just makes the whole place, the city, a much better place? You know, I'm very optimistic about it. Bendigo's great and it's going to get better.
That's a great moment, way to throw to you now, and your chance to ask a few questions. I think we've got some microphones left and right, so stick your hand in the air and introduce yourself and ask the question under our civil society rules, which govern tonight.
Good evening, and thank you for a most interesting discussion. My name is Brenda Stevens-Chambers. I'm a retired school teacher and nurse. I've worked much of my life in Melbourne in multicultural first hospitals and then schools. Now, from your discussion, I have a few points. You've reminded me of someone who said that television would be the opium of the masses. Tonight's discussion has reminded me of that, and I would agree with that statement.
Do you have a question?
I'm making observations, then view, and that if you have a good idea, don't tell the government about it. I'd agree with that completely. Now, Australians, it was John Howard who said that all he wanted was to relax with Australia. Well, he already had it. I'm concerned, and I'm sure there is a long time that it is improving. So that is basically a statement, and make of it what you will. Thank you.
Has my own birth certificate. So I have a vested interest in this discussion. I come from a non-English speaking background. I'm a post-war refugee. So I actually have an interest in this sort of area. But I also come from a peasant background. My parents were very process workers. I was lucky enough. I made it, you know, I had the opportunities in life. But I still relate very strongly, and I relate very strongly to ordinary working class people, which I come across, and I've heard amongst ordinary people, whether it's the pub or the social club or whatever, these types of discussions. Now, I agree, yes, it was open, but a lot of people would not know that this was on.
So it's terrific that you've come, though, Irene. Yeah, it's terrific that you've come. I mean, that's fantastic.
Well, the thing is,
can I add to that?
I've been fortunate enough to be able to know what's going on and to have the opportunities in my life. But I'd still like to know, because you see, you talk about a discussion and informed, and this will then, what happens here is going to be fed further along the line and be accessed by people. This is my concern. And if this is not representative of ordinary Bendigonians, it means that it's a slice of a particular group's perception.
It is, but it's not the only forum that can happen on this issue either.
I would like to respond to that. I think the points that you raise are really important. And I would like to also say that sometimes it's really difficult and we don't always do it well as university or as professionals. And I'll just be really honest. We were called into Robinvale, Swan Hill government, because we have an international group of students and they really wanted to get the views of the farm workers, the factory workers out there, a lot of whom are Vietnamese, Tongan, and don't speak English. And the reason why we were called in is because the council wanted to show that they were serious about wanting to speak to a diverse group of people. And even then, it was still difficult because of the concern of who we were and whether we were actually spying on them. So that's one reality. In terms of being able to bring this out to, let's say, your workplace, to your workmates, we actually need help to learn how to do that. And if you'd like, I'm happy to meet with you afterward and to give you my contact so we can discuss how to do it. I think from my own students who are often from first in family, they come in and they feel like a fraud because a university is what these people do. The people in the city are the intelligent ones. And we have to figure out how to overcome those barriers so that you're right. Mm. You and other people are involved in this conversation and know your place in it, which is to be an equal partner in it.
Jim Dannock's my name. I was just interested, I suppose, on economics play a big part on a community. Bendigo's history is gold, industrial, probably till about 20 years ago. The Bendigo bank model probably changed a little bit of perceptions, I think, of what we're about. So as that changes, that economic base, and I think today it's even more diverse and very different given technology, what identifies with that sort of work, so economic base?
Well, Rob, you've had a lot to say on the sort of economic structural change that might be, the next stage for Bendigo?
Yeah, well, and I know Jim well. I mean, big issue, Jim, is to get the changes happening in terms of the types of proposals. We've got some really innovative businesses. We've got some, new technology businesses. We've got a raft of skill and competency, but how often does that get in the one room talking about some of our future agenda? And it doesn't. And there is a really concerted effort, like I said, through the business sector and through, the local government, trying to pull those thought processes through, because there's no doubt that, as I said earlier, capital always finds its way to opportunity. It's a little slower if you are not good enough to put your case early enough. And we need to put our case because we've got to get some structural change as well. Structural change in terms of what are we offering, how are we going to have other people participate, what are our goals, how do we manage the risks, all those end up just applying for grants instead of actually, being on a proactive way. So, Jim, I'm optimistic because there is substantial skill and capacity to collaboratively put together proposals here that will actually be able to attract capital, which will create employment activity and get us off the conversations that are about differences and get us onto the conversation about our future. And economics will drive it. We've just got to get the balance back again, where we get our share of that capital productively used and properly earned, in the sense that we are paying our dues for that capital from whencever it came.
whether it's the capital markets, whether it's, you know, whether there's a new retail bond structure that might emerge in Australia, because at some point it will, because at the moment with a concentration of long-term savings in super, there's a too much of that held in just the equity structure. So eventually they'll be looking for opportunities to plant and in innovative communities and businesses and activities. So my view is it's up to us. Most of what is required is for us to prepare our case and our worthiness when that capital starts to flow.
Can I say something, Francis, sorry, in that regard? And Jim, you know this, and I have a real concern about, and yes, we have to be innovative, and we must be innovative, because, and you mentioned manufacturing, so much manufacturing has gone from all of Australia, but in Bendigo particular, from the days when we had Brad Mill and we had Perfect Fit and we had John Brown and lots and Mayfair and lots of factories. And we worry about what are people going to do who like making stuff and doing things and don't want to work in IT and don't want to work in hospitality. So, I mean, I think it's a real challenge for Bendigo to come up with businesses and encourage businesses and foster businesses that really provide employment for those who like to make stuff and do stuff. Not necessarily in an old-fashioned way, but there's a lot of people who don't want to go to university and don't, therefore TAFE is a very good option. So, you know, I mean, when we chose to close our factory last year, there's almost nobody gone into furniture because there is no other furniture manufacturing really here, so I had to find other jobs. It's hard.
Yeah, but what I'm saying, Margot, is that we know that's a core skill or a core aspiration. The way you actually do it is to pull the people together that have actually got that interest and see if you can prepare a framework. I mean, I sent to Francis, I did an Alfred Deakin lecture back in 95 and one to the university back in probably late 1998, and there were sort of 10 elements or 10 ingredients of sustainability, sustainable communities, and probably 8 of them can be impacted by the people in this room, in this community, and only a few can be impacted by outside, and yet, at the moment, most of what happens here has to be decided somewhere else, which is actually says the equation, you know, the balance is not right, and the only way we change that is we change it.
Have we got some more questions from the floor? We'll go to this side because we've been over there for a bit. So,
my name is Mustafa Arawi. I'm a resident of Bendigo for the last 17 years, and I hope I will stay here a bit longer. My question is the word fear. We use it a lot on our conversation tonight, and people who have fear from spiders, they will know that there will be no rational thinking. If you see a spider, you're not thinking that in reality spider's purpose in life is not to attack you as a human, and physically you're a lot bigger than them, you can kill them. So with Muslim community and that fear that is being created, chances people who are fearing Muslims not thinking rational, they're not thinking, let me investigate, is it really what I'm hearing in the news true or not? How can we change that? How can we remove that fear while the politicians and the media continue to bombard people with this fear? How can we remove that fear so people can think rational?
Who wants to take that, Margot? Believe in Bendigo, that was what it was about, wasn't it?
Well, yeah, and I think we just have to talk about facts. You know, that's what Rob was saying before. It's got to be true. But people have got to actually want to believe the truth or hear the truth or recognise the truth also, because, you know, some folk are happy to accept anything that anybody says, but you've got to work out who is saying the truth, and the truth and facts are very, very important.
Yes. There's a lot of fake news and alternative facts.
Okay. Can you believe that? Post-truth.
No, I have to, absolutely, post-truth as well.
I have to slightly disagree in this a little bit, because in terms of my research on risk, I think so there's some truth in this, but there's also some of barriers. And the way that we look for cognitive affirmation about what we think and how that feeds into our fear process. And I think that for dealing with that fear, for sure, the facts are valuable once a person's at a certain point. To get them to that point, I think it's the listening say, I understand, is coming out as anger and as hatred. Yeah. And how do you transfer it back? For me, the question is, how do you get over the anger and hatred to go back into the emotion of fear? Because at least if it's fearful, you then have something to work with. I think, a little bit easier. So there might be a few processes. I think psychologists would be far better placed to answer that. But the emotional has to be dealt with as well as the cognitive.
I think it also comes back to leadership as well. I mean, leaders have to be held account for inciting violence and hatred and creating climates of anxiety and fear based on the bogeyman, which at this stage is the cultural bogeyman is the Muslim. So as long as the institutions and systems are invested in perpetuating that us and them, where the them is always the Muslim, accountability lies with them. Not everyone is going to have an opportunity to sit down and have a cuppa with a Muslim. That's not always going to be the case. But nor should the burden of proof be on the Muslim to constantly negate every negative stereotype that is about them. And I've lost count of how many times I've been offended by people saying, well, how do you feel about those bombings? And I'm like saying, well, how do you feel about those pedophiles? Which is completely unreasonable, hyped up scenario of what Muslims represent in the West by leaders in this country has a lot to answer for.
We'll go to this side of the room now.
Tony, Vincent de Paul. Each year we're seeing increasing numbers of people turn up for assistance from us. Our numbers at the present time are in excess of 10,000. A high percentage of those people are unemployed people. They receive about $200 a week. What can we do to bring those sort of people along with us in the development of Bendigo? And more importantly, how can we give them some self-pride, self-esteem?
Well, to build some community capital as well, some social capital, not just the capital markets.
That's right. I think it really has to come from within in terms of the business capacity, you know, the businesses themselves. And it's fair to say my assessment of the lack of business investment in Australia through this period, you know, I think there's a frustration at the Reserve Bank right now where everyone's waiting for the gun to go off and expect interest rates at their low level to suddenly, you know, reignite demand. You know, we require, in fact, I think, you know, business investment to be, you know, to be elevated and lifted, and a bet's being made, as I call it. So coming back down to those people, the best thing we can do is to provide really productive, contributory work. So we, as the business community and the community as a whole, have to work out ways to make sure that we give them that sense of pride and contribution. We all know the basic humanness is we all long to belong, we long to be able to contribute, and we long to be valued for contribution. Those three elements should be embodied in business, and we should be working out ways to have people belong to something that's meaningful, be able to contribute, and be valued. And so my challenge is it's got to come, you know, to businesses to be able to be, you know, stepping forward and saying, yeah, we're going to make something happen where those people are, in fact, given those extra layers of value in their life of making a contribution.
I think that's important. I think the long-term, you know, goal and aspiration of employment options and employment places is absolutely critical. But I think in many cases when you've got clients presenting to a lot of these services, which, let's face it, have had so much funding cut in the last 24 months by federal government, is a massive issue. And when you assess their well-being to include mental health issues, the wider net of support that needs government funding is actually really critical right now.
Yeah.
So when those mental health issues aren't addressed, manifest into other health issue. So really it's about what employment being is important, yep, and funding institutions who are at the core of delivering those services at that level is vital. It's too easy to say, oh, they're all dull bludgers or they're all, yeah, you know, hope. That's just really, I mean, that's extremely offensive and insulting to Australians for any leader to take that particular view. So systemic change is needed with funding from primary services right up, because without that, it's just a band-aid.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
I agree, and I think from my understanding of often how some clients are treated when they walk into our government institutions for assistance, mm-hmm, that completely entrenches the sense of worthlessness, and especially the debate that we are having right now in our policies.
We are looking to over here.
My name's that's loud, isn't it? My name's Cheryl. I've been interested to hear about creating change at a systemic structural level, but also Irene's comment at a more community level. And Margot, I wondered your great idea that you did in your business. Imagine if Bendigo, at the local community level, we were encouraged by our local council or some other believe in Bendigo to actually connect with our own neighbourhoods. If we all connected with four people in our neighbourhoods and found out what are the things that draw us together, what are the things that we have in common, as well as what are the things we celebrate difference. So as well as all the big picture, really important, strategic, it's got to come back to us as citizens and community to be connecting, you know, with each other, because many of us are isolated in our very own neighbourhoods. And I just wonder whether there's some ideas that we could do at a really grassroots level.
Cheryl, I really agree with you about neighbourhoods too, because I've always lived in lots of places and had great relationships with neighbours. And we now live over the road in View Street, above a shop, and the one big thing I really miss is neighbours. And there are other people who live in the city too, but you can't have a yak over the fence or share a fag with somebody over the fence or a glass of wine at 5 o'clock or have a chat while you're doing things. Neighbourhoods are very, very, very important. Very important.
Francis, could I just add that it's in everyone's interest, you know, and particularly business, to think about the whole impact, you know, of people and their community, their well-being, because it has a direct impact on their health and their contribution. It has a direct impact on absences, because usually something's going on in their life that's not right. And there's a bit of self-interest in this. If you end up a really good employer and recognise these changes and take some corrective action, or get engaged with other parts of the community to allow this community reach its full potential, guess who the beneficiaries will be? The businesses, right? Because that's economics works in a way that it does actually provide support. But I don't actually hear a lot of that type of discussion, although I did start to hear a lot of that discussion with some of the discussion in Bendigo, with some of the types of things that the Bendigo businesses are now starting to talk about, that wholesome well-being of the workforce and that powerful force in terms of feeding and supporting business, and willing to make their own investment in time in building leadership capability and building participation levels in the bigger business than just performing a function. So I'm a bit optimistic that business is actually recognising some of the challenges it has to get to reach its full potential itself.
I think we've got a few more questions before they're going to ring the last bell on us here.
My name's Kay O'Brien. At the start of the meeting, you stated that we weren't going to dwell over the last couple of years. Mm. Most of the night's been talking about the mosque, Muslims, believe in Bendigo. I am against the mosque. Not one person has come to me. Not one. Why hasn't anybody come and asked why I don't want a mosque?
I'm actually happy to do that, because I've been doing research and I was looking for people to speak to and I couldn't find anyone
at
the time.
I'm here and I'm willing to talk.
All right, well, I will come and meet you as a group, because I actually found it difficult, and it was because of the polarisation. No one, when I was looking for it, I was trying to contact the anti-mosque leaders on the internet. No one responded to me. I tried through various service groups, footy clubs, and I actually couldn't break in.
Well, ask any councillor that's here. Ask CEO. I have been here 4 years. How many times, James, have I spoken out at board meetings? But and nobody takes notice, and yet I'm the bigot, I'm the racist, I'm the Nazi scum whore, the whole lot, because I have a different opinion to other people, and it's got nothing to do with fear of Muslims. I have spoken with Muslims. I have sat down and had coffee with Muslims. I don't like the Quran. I don't want a mosque here. The council has hidden so many things about the plan to start with. We have been shut down to have our word at every meeting.
Can I just ask then? So this process went through, and we don't want to... Tonight wasn't about relitigating that event. It was about trying to learn from the experience of it. So I hope you understand that tonight we weren't simply trying to...
I come along to listen, to have an open mind.
Yeah.
Margot, you were bringing up things about certain councillors that weren't leaders. Now, we all know who you were talking about, because they had a different view to you about a mosque.
But can I just ask, the process, this is interesting, and we are going to run out of time, and I wish I'd have brought this up during the discussion. The notion of democracy.
Yes.
The notion that this process that you talk about went through council, it went through VCAT, it went to the courts, it was litigated all the way up the chain of all the institutions that should govern us, that, you know, as a community, we as mutual self-interest decide will determine how we will resolve disputes, because we've got to have a process like that or we've got anarchy. And yet it came to a particular outcome, and it was seen, despite all that level of involvement and all that participation and those institutions that govern our democracy, to be undemocratic. How could that be the case? I want someone to explain it to me.
I think I'll just speak from a particular perspective, and that's from a planning perspective. We see a lot of things going on in the world, and people like yourself don't get very many opportunities to actually sit and have a real conversation where someone's listening fully. What happens is, in a thing like the development application for the mosque, the legislation provides what we can and can't discuss. So that means you needed to be heard, but that to engage in the democratic process is also part of our democratic process, which is fantastic. Where the democracy starts...
Was it undemocratic process?
It wasn't an undemocratic process. There's all these opportunities, but in terms of who has the larger voice and who has the power and how it works out is, over the long term, what we're constantly trying to address, what we're constantly trying to negotiate in terms of who we are as a society. And that's obviously a space where you felt very silenced, where we do have to, where we do have problems in democracy, and where it's really quite difficult is in our passions for what we believe in. For us, we only truly believe, for some of us at least, we only truly believe that democracy has been achieved if we get our own way. And I think that that's what we're seeing in the US and in Britain and also here, where we have to remember it's the systems that we have that protect all of our rights to protest, to have a voice, to seek to meet with our representatives, with respect. Engaging in conversation even while we disagree is where we're failing.
Can we get to that point where we can engage at this point? And tonight's not the night because we're
running out of
time.
I don't know, but if they're willing to speak to me, I'll come
listen. I'm really
interested.
Is there still a way forward to have a conversation about this that isn't one full of accusations and vitriol? I'm asking you now. Because do you feel?
Thanks. Francis, can I answer too? Like you said earlier, that there's a lot of people talking and not many people listening. And so I'd like to bring up a point. My worldview says that, you know, we're all made in the image of God. Everyone has great value, therefore, and we're to respect one another. So why is it that if I have a problem with a particular worldview and your educated people and our eminent professor up here, we get brushed off as if we're racist and bigots? We have a genuine concern. We've heard the rhetoric, but we're also seeing the reality that's happening all through our Western nations, through Europe. You know, I think the first thing for us to have dialogue with is to understand that we're not racists, we're not bigots, we're not this irrational, fear-filled people. We have genuine concerns. That, I think, is our first base that we need to get to. And until we do, we're at loggerheads.
No, I think those fears, and I think the fears that you have and the ability to articulate those fears is legitimate. Absolutely. But I also think it's important, if you are going to state a specific fear, for there to be an opportunity for that to be either responded to by the person who is the subject of your fear, which would be presumably a Muslim. And then beyond that point, it's each to his own. So I can't convince you to join Team Islam. It's not my goal or my role. My goal is to just want to, as if I were living in Bendigo, to live here harmoniously like everybody else and have the right to go to school, go to the butcher, go to the shops and pray if I wanted to. That's pretty much what it comes down to. And I don't want to speak on behalf of the Bendigo Muslims here because I think they can do that for themselves. But their right and their entitlements are just as important as yours.
Now, it's a question that can be addressed in another forum, but tonight was not about relitigating
the events of the last few years. It was about discussing what we learnt from it. So, and we have run out of time. And I suggest that everyone who wants to have society rules, use that. We can't do that tonight because they're going to kick us out. But I want to thank you for coming along. It's only the beginning of a conversation that you all need to have together. Can you thank our panellists, Margot, Julie, Tasneem, and Rob?
Thank you, guys.
For the Trobe University. And hopefully we'll be back up in Bendigo real soon. Yeah. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's get a photo. Can I get a photo of this on the panel?
There's drinks downstairs. Right, Chris, downstairs.